welcome. And I'm very happy to see so many people at the last talk of the day. I know many of you are tired. I promise not to melt your brain even more. So this talk is based on an article I wrote for PHP Architect a few years ago, because I did the research for my company internally, and then it proved out that it's so complex a topic, and then everybody has a completely different opinion about the branching strategies, that it could be packed in an article and done at conferences. So, a very small background about myself. Maybe you've known me. I've been here at IPC. This is the third time already in Berlin. I had much more interesting topics like chatbots and other things last year. Not only I write code and help others do it, but I'm also a mother, which is like a full-time job. We have a lot of other things, like my passion is to craft enterprise applications with PHP. I know it can be done because I've done it numerous times. And most of the other people are making fun of us, right? Like you cannot do a highly scalable application or other things in PHP. It's not the language for that. I dare to disagree. My biggest application was trafficking $80 million in one day through the platform, and we crashed the payment provider. So if somebody tells you don't use PHP, you have arguments against that. A few years ago, I did something quite interesting. I organized the first conference in Romania, the national one. I had no idea how to organize a conference, and I strongly advise you to follow this kind of paths. Try the new and unexpected. It was amazing, and one of the attendees is actually here in the audience and enjoying IPC. I don't have a full-time job. I don't have a kid. I don't organize conferences. So I decided I have all the time in the world for a PhD. So that's what I started 2.5 years ago. That's also a completely different topic. I also encourage you to do the academic path, even if you stop halfway, you will learn a lot of things. Yesterday I had a talk about software engineering and data scientists, how they can work together in a team. So this is something that I learned in my current job and in my still ongoing PhD. Enough about me. Let me tell you something about my husband. He's an archaeologist, and we live in a very nice city in Romania, in Transylvania. I call it the Disneyland of archaeology, because they have Neolithic period, they have Roman period, medieval stuff. Everywhere you start digging, you will find things. The interesting part about this is that they have to do it for every house that gets built. They have to exploit that particular piece of land, the footprint of the house, and they will find all kinds of things. To me, it reminds me of our Git histories. So the older a project is, the more it looks like this, or even like this. So when we are going to use Git, it's not just to keep things in version control and look into the future and do the builds for the present, but sometimes we need to go way back in the past. And it's not a trivial task. One thing, I want to set your expectations a little bit. Today, we are not going to talk about how you are going to use Git on a daily basis. I'm sure you can learn this. It's very easy. There is no magic bullet on how to use Git. Nobody invented it for that reason, any version control. And something that you might have expected, I'm not going to show you how to solve conflicts. At the same time, when using any tool or technology, there will never be a recipe that I can share with you. You take it home, apply it, and then you have a perfect dinner, right? So I apologize, we will not have those. I read a lot of books. I pick them usually from airports and train stations. And at some point, the HBR, you know what the HBR is? Harvard Business Review. They do some summaries, they condensed articles in one book. This is one of them, The Change Management, and it really caught my attention. Because they talk about change management in organizations, about teams, about people. That has nothing to do with the Git history. But still, what we do with the version control on a daily basis is a change management system. Because every incremental modification that we do is a change. And Git is helping us to manage that change. So if you want to broaden your horizon just a little bit on how these things are done outside the technical world, this is one of the books that you can definitely pick up. So if we are going to make like a very brief summary, what are we going to learn today is I want you to leave this room with a framework that will help you choose whatever branching strategy fits you, your project today, or will fit it in the future, and learn what mistakes you might have done in the past. And for that, we need like a small framework, like mindset. We will point out some of the parts where money is draining out, so that you can also be conscious about that, and if you want or can, fix also those parts. And I would like to believe that you will also know where to look when you want to get even more help. So, version control systems, who uses them? Exactly, everybody. In a Stack Overflow survey, which is not the most accurate data source in the world, but let's try to use it as a reference, right? You see Git has a very high percentage of usage. At the same time, if you add all the numbers, you obtain more than 100%. So there are more people using multiple version control systems. You can see that CVS and Perforce and some other things are still being used. So there are a lot of enterprise environments where we are used to work with completely different version control systems than Git. And I can promise you, Git is the best one so far. It's the easiest. And one that is used mostly in open source and in the modern world, right? But there are multiple others. Let's try to think how the world looks like when you don't have a version control system. So let's say I'm trying to prepare for this presentation, right? I'm not going to commit it in Git. Come on, this is outrageous. So I'll probably have like a project and final and live and final seven something, right? This is still a version control system. Modern version control systems have this categorization of being distributed and non-distributed. Who here remembers CVS and has actually used it? Thank you, quite a lot. And then we had, of course, SVN and SourceSafe and all the other ones, right? This is not ancient history. Some people still use it on a daily basis. I found some teams in my current company who do that. Do you know who this guy is? Yep, Torvalds. What did he create? Kernel and Git. Okay. But do you know why he created Git? Somebody does. Almost correct. So, in maintaining the Linux kernel, they were working with patches. Everybody was just sending files and they were applying those patches to the repository and it was very complicated. And at some point, they went on and used a couple of other things, and one that they settled for is called Gatekeeper. Gatekeeper had exactly one problem. It was perfect for their needs, but had one problem. It was not open source. It was proprietary software. There was a company selling it. And in the terms and conditions, somewhere hidden in those 1 million pages, there was a clause that said, you are not allowed to reverse engineer or to do other things on top of this piece of software. You have to use it as is, right? Don't hack it. Of course, somebody working for the Linux kernel hacked it and used some meta information He was taking meta information from that version control system to show users and count how many commits or whatever. He did something useful, a tool. And then they found out. And then they revoked the license from this team. And for the teams who were doing open source, they weren't selling it, right? So it was like given for free. They revoked all of these licenses for everybody in the world, not just for the Linux kernel team. So then Linux found himself in the middle of a conflict, so he went home. And after 1 week, he came up with a version control that was a system that was open source, and that would work for the needs of the Linux kernel, which was one of the biggest projects at the time, right, with the most contributors. So, one of his quotes that I picked up is that Git is not perfect, nothing is perfect in this world, but it solves the most problems of version control systems in a way that other people haven't solved in the same software package before. So let's go quickly through the structure of the presentation. I hope you like the story. We will first have a look at the stakeholders, who is actually using a version control system, be it Git or another one. What are the concepts that we will find over and over in the literature, called blog posts and tutorials and other things? What are the strategies that other people employ? And this part we will skip. As we said in the beginning of the talk, we will not have time for Q&A. So let's look a little bit at the stakeholders. Do you recognize this guy? Are you this guy, the developer? Most of the time, right? So the mindset of a developer while using a version control system is very linear. I'm doing a piece of work, and then I'm going to commit this change, and I'm going to do another piece of work, and I'm going to commit this change, right? Like one branch rules them all. The developer doesn't need a gazillion branches. The tester, he found a complete mess, and he needs to point to the bugs. They still need to grab a piece of software in order to test. For them, the problem is much more complicated, because the main line, which is commonly referred to as trunk or master, might contain all the history, but some people are working on bug fixes, other people are working on features. The tester is only interested at the point where the bug fix branch is what is the status of the code before going into master. So he looks at something completely different than the developer. There are roles. This one might be automated, the integrator, but it might also not be automated. So, for example, in my team, we had the code review strategy, where people look at the code and inspect it before merging it, before assigning the permission. What the integrator role cares about is, can I merge this branch into the mainline? Yes or no? Do I have conflicts? Will it introduce regression? And then there's the package builder. This is also a role that can be automated, and in continuous integration, continuous delivery environments, it is always the case. They look only at the linear version. They don't care where the code is coming from. They care that that commit represents a package. And it might be the ugliest piece of code ever written. They need to build this package into a deployable form and pass it over. Or it might be a nicely beautiful piece of code, right? It's not important if it's an alpha stage thing or if it's the latest version of the Linux kernel. What's important is, how do I get all this code out of the version control and create a package out of it? So they care about the commit that needs, the last one, that needs to be transformed into a package. And then we have the deployer. The deployer has no notion of version control. They only care about the package. They take the package and install it, right? So you can already see that there are so many different points of view that are looking at the same thing and working with it on a daily basis. Imagine you're a bug hunter. You're a developer, somebody, the tester or the automation system told you you have a problem, right? And you have to go back and retrace what went wrong. So what normally happens, some people open a branch from the release and try to fix it there and do all the testing and other things. You look at the mainline, you have no idea what caused the problem. You find it in the code, but you also have to explain where did it come from. Because if I make this small change to lines of code, what else will I affect? Will I introduce regressions while fixing this particular issue? So you have to go and do all the archaeological thing to make sure you're not breaking things for anybody else. And then our favorite colleague, the project manager, who is actually looking at the problem in a completely different way. They have something that's live, they know a lot of things are coming up, and the development teams are working on various features. They care if the features are in a good state or not. Is it done yet? Is it working, right? Some of them are not going to work, some of them are. Another thing that the project manager cares about is, do these feature branches integrate with each other correctly? And I've seen cases a few years ago where a few completely different teams with different sprints and different backlogs were working on the same code base. They spent between 2 and 3 days every sprint to fix that merging thing, because they were working almost all the time on the core, and somebody was updating the core in one way, and somebody from another team in another feature branch was making another improvement, and most of the time was spent in conflict. Why? Because they were only integrating at the end of the sprint, right? And we'll talk about that one later. So you see, there are many people looking, people and automation systems, looking at the same Git repository with completely different mindsets. They need different kind of information from it. So let's go through the theoretical concepts. We mentioned before mainline, which is a generic term. In Git, we use a master. In SVN, it used to be called trunk, right? That's the main branch. And it's very easy to do all the commits and other things. So I won't insist there. There are public branches and local branches, right? So if you, I try to take a screenshot like, okay, the master branch is public, but I can create a README branch or a testing branch or documentation, something, feature, bug fix. And that is local, private to my environment until I push it remotely. And this is quite an important thing to remember. This is another screenshot of the PHP Git repository from a while back. So you can see there are many, many branches. Look how many commits are behind the mainline. So these are unmaintained branches, right? They're ephemeral. They lived for a while, and then nobody cared about them. The long-lived branches are the ones that are actually going to be maintained for a while. So if we maintain the, I don't know, the last three versions of our code base, the last three major versions, then everything else is a candidate for removal. Okay. Another concept, also theory, a topic branch. Some people call them feature branches, right? Topic is a more appropriate term, I would say, but to each their own. So you can see that from the main line, from the master branch, we go on, in this example, an authentication branch, and do an implementation of the Facebook authentication or Twitter or whatever other social media things we want to use on this branch, which is topic specific. There are two kinds of workflows. The one that everybody learns first is called the merge workflow. So in the topic branch, if something happens on the main line, there are new commits, we just merge whatever happened there into our branch. One thing that is important to remember is that this creates a new commit in our branch. Right? So we will have one more commit, and another one, and another one. If you work on a very large project, this is how the history will look over time. So most of the commits here are merge pull request, merge something else, mode, remote tracking branch, and so on and so on. So the merge workflow introduces a lot of noise in your history. Maybe you don't care about this while you're developing, but this is why we talked about all the other roles. Because it's not just developers working on this code base, so you maybe don't want this noise. And this one I picked from a project that I actually worked on, I think a couple of years ago. And you can see we also have reverts. So somebody was very sloppy. And he was merging and then reverting and doing other things. The amount of noise in this history is very, very high. I cannot find what's going on because everything is a merge or something. On the other hand, if we have a rebase workflow, are you familiar with rebase? Is everybody, anybody using rebase? Thank you. This is a very good audience. Then you are very aware of the fact that when you do a rebase, your changes are reapplied on top of what happened on master, and new commits are created and are replacing the old ones. So the SHA code is different after you do a rebase. Now, this is where the debate starts. Should we use a stable trunk or not? But what is a stable trunk? Right. So most agile companies are using this notion of the master branch, the main line, is always releasable. So the only thing that I need to do to make a release is put a tag and start the build system because a new tag appeared. Everything that I put on the main line can go into production. Right? This is the stable trunk. Real life is not so easy. There are many people working. We have other ways of working and constraints. And sometimes it's considered a more safe approach to have a separate release branch from the main line, where everybody puts their code. And then that release branch is also used for fixes before we actually tag and perform the release. If you are too tired to remember anything else from this talk, please remember this slide. Come on. The integration pipeline. So this is a concept that I found extremely useful. What it says is that people are working on various topic branches, bug fixes, features, whatever, one, two, three. Instead of moving them to the master, because our environment doesn't allow for it, right? We are using release branches and other things. We want to have an integration branch that is short-lived. It's an ephemeral branch. We're just playing like a dry run. Let's see if these two features merge together. This is the dream of any project manager. This is exactly what they want. Do these features work together? Do a partial release from the integration branch, do all the tests, and then discard it because they will be safely integrated into master, the branches. We can trust them. These things work together, right? So you can use this concept in many ways and in many situations. Now, I want to go through the strategies that other people use, right? So let's just look. What are the others doing? Some developers work on projects on an individual basis. They are like lone wolves. They just do everything in one branch, and it's perfectly fine. I want to point out that sometimes when people are frustrated with their working environment, even if they work in a team, their mindset will revert to this strategy. So if you find somebody having a very long-lived branch that only they work on, it's the lone wolf strategy. And then it will be very difficult to integrate their work back into the mainline. So just be aware that this is not just for freelancers, okay? I turned this picture around to have the notion of time. Are you familiar with Gitflow? Are you using it at work? No. Okay. Finally, the world has become a better place. Thank you. What Gitflow says is that we have a master branch where we tag the where we use releases from. But everything, all the work is happening on the develop branch, all the noise. Every time we want to work on a feature, we branch from the develop one. And then when we finally decide to do a merge back into the master, that's already not a stable master. We don't guarantee that the trunk is stable. We are going to have another branch called release, and it's very, very complicated. And most of the teams try it first, and then they run away from it. It is very valuable in some environments. So if you work in a corporate environment, this actually sets out the rules, and nobody just says we are not going to follow the rules. And this might be a good thing. But at the same time, introduces a lot of noise because everything that is going in the Gitflow strategies is a merge variant. So you'll have all those merge this branch into this other one and all the noise in the history. It will be quite difficult to find what you were looking for. Other companies like GitHub use the stable trunk approach. So everything that is going to be done is on a very short-lived branch. We are going to test, and whenever we are done, we come back into the master and release it on a daily basis. They can afford it because they are a software as a service company. But if we work, for example, if we prepare desktop applications that we sell to customers, the last version that we gave them was I don't know how many months ago, this one will not work. Because they're not using the latest master all the time. So then we need something more like Gitflow. Right? There's another thing called simple Git workflow, where it's exactly the same strategy as the GitHub flow, but instead of the pull request being merged as... that one is using a rebase. This one, the pull request, says an explicit merge. Right? So it taints a little bit the history, but not too much, because the changes are very small. So you just come back with one one change. Somebody else is using workflow for agile teams. This one, I will not give you my personal favorites right now, but what I will tell you is that I believe this one mitigates very well the need for the QA team, if you have a separate QA team outside of your development. They have this notion of, you have to give me my branch. So the QA branch is the one that is used for releases, because they don't believe in the stable master approach. Sometimes the testing teams are too scared of the stable master approach. So they use the QA branch as a release branch. So if you work in such an environment, this might be a good idea to use. Another software as a service company, it's called GitLab. What they do is they somehow try to match the need for agile and software as a service with offline installations of their product, because they offer you a download version, right? And you just put it on your server. And then the upgrade path there is completely different as if you would use their cloud. This is very appropriate if you don't work in a 100% cloud environment. So in enterprises, most of the time, everything is on the company servers. So if you work on the company server, then you're going to be using the stable release branches, right? So what the GitLab does is master is stable for their preparation of the next release, and the major features are being upgraded one by one to a staging environment, but the staging environment is built from a staging branch. So instead of building from the master, they build it from a separate branch where they promote these features. And then everything goes to production, they use another branch for that. That's the agile way. And everything else is happening on stable branches with specific bug fixes that are being cherry-picked. So do you know what cherry-pick is? Yeah, quite a few. So for those who don't, if I have a commit in a completely different branch of my tree, and I know that commit can be applied on my branch, I say git cherry-pick, and I pick that SHA, and the delta is applied to my branch. So I just steal that one commit from the branch, not having to merge it entirely. And remember the story with Linus creating it for his kernel? This is the strategy that is described in a man page. So that they use for releasing the Linux kernel, which is quite a complex piece of software. So if you look here, they have four long-lived branches. The main T contains the last stable release. And then everything that they want to do for the next release is on the master branch. Now, because people can contribute to the Linux kernel in two ways, one having access to the Git repository, and another one where they're outside of the circle of trust, the people outside of the circle of trust are going to send patches. And the patches are being applied to the proposed updates branch by people from inside the circle of trust, so they do have a Git account. They apply that patch on the proposed updates branch, and then if the tests pass or whatever other criteria are fulfilled, that patch is promoted from the proposed updates branch to the integration testbed, which is called next. Right, and from there it gets promoted to master. It's quite a simple strategy, right? Not very complicated. And I want to leave you with a couple of words from a very old philosopher. He died a long time ago. He's American, by the way. And he said that we are becoming the tools of our tools. So the advice that I have for you is don't become dependent on the tools that are surrounding you. Use them to your advantage. So if you want to combine a couple of ideas from all this slide, and that is the strategy that fits you, that's perfect. Or if you already have one of them that caught your eye and you believe your current project is going to benefit it, then use that one. Thank you.